Hi everyone. So today we'll cover sequences and mathematical induction. So first of all, what is a sequence? A sequence is a function whose domain is either all the integers between two given integers, like m and n, or all the integers greater than or equal with a given integer, like a of m, a of m plus 1, a of m plus 2, and so on to plus infinity. For a sequence, we can basically choose an index or a subscript like k, which will be instantiated with all the numbers between m and n or greater than or equal with m. In that case, a of k is called the term of that sequence. Basically, it's a generic term that stands for all the elements in the sequence. M is the subscript of the initial term, and n, in case that there is an upper limit for the index in that sequence, is the subscript of the last term. The initial term is important in case that we want to prove some property using induction, and we'll discuss a little bit more about induction later. Basically, it's a valid logical argument that allows us to prove a property for an infinite number of elements in a sequence. And how do we do that? We basically prove the first case, and then we'll prove that for any element, any index greater than that first case m, if the property holds for the element, let's call it k, then the property will also hold for the element k plus 1. So now, basically, the fact that the initial case is true will propagate throughout the entire sequence, even if that sequence is an infinite sequence. So mathematical induction allows us to prove a property to be true for an infinite number of elements in a sequence. That's why it's a little bit different than the ones that we talked before, because it allows us to propagate truth to infinity. Now, sequences are usually defined in three different ways. One is to enumerate the elements of the sequence. Another one is to explicitly give a formula, like the one that we have below, that is a general rule that shows how to compute a of k depending on the index k. And there is a third way to declare a sequence using recursion, which we'll return back later. So an explicit formula for every element of the sequence, a of k, here we have an example, is 2 to the power k. So basically, if we are told that k is greater than or equal with 1, then this a of k equal with 2 to the power k is the sequence that is enumerated next. Basically, for k equal 1, then 2 to the power 1 is 2. For k equal 2, then 2 to the power 2 is 4. For k equal 3, 2 to the power 3 is 8, and so on. So basically, if we are asked what is 2 to the power 8, or a of 8, it's 2 to the power 8, which is 256. So basically, this explicit formula tells us what are the elements of the sequence. Now, for explicit formulas, we also have to give the range of k. So in fact, this is not totally complete. We should also declare that we are asking for any k greater than or equal with 1. Okay, so let me just copy this. For all k greater than or equal with 1. Okay. So basically, it's a way to declare a formula for all of the elements of the sequence, for any index greater than the lower limit of this sequence. Another example is declared below. For instance, a of k is equal with k divided by k plus 1 for all integers k greater than or equal with 1. And that's the general formula, the explicit formula, for the next elements of the sequence. For instance, a of 1 will be 1 divided by 2, a of 2 is 2 divided by 3, a of 3 is 3 divided by 4, and so on. Now, that range where we start the index is actually, it can be a variable range. So the same sequence can be written in an alternative form as the sequence B of I, where B of I is equal with I minus 1 divided by I for all integers I greater than or equal with 2. If we replace I with 2, then the formula becomes 2 minus 1 divided by 2, which is 1 divided by 2. B of 3 would be 3 minus 1 divided by 3, which is 2 divided by 3, and so on. And we actually observe that the elements are the same in these two sequences. First element is 1 divided by 2, second element is 2 divided by 3, and so on. So in fact, these are two explicit formulas for the same sequence. A of k for all k greater than or equal with 1 is actually the same sequence with the B of i's for all i's greater than or equal with 2. So there may be multiple explicit formulas for the same sequence. Any questions? Again, feel free to ask me any questions at any time during the lecture. And you can do it in two different ways. You can post the question in the chat, or you can basically just unmute yourself and ask the question. Next, we define an alternating sequence. Alternating sequences are those in which the alternating elements, consecutive elements in the sequence, are positive and negative. So the sign in the alternating elements switches every single time that we basically look at two consecutive elements. And this is an example of such an alternating sequence. C of j is equal with minus 1 to the power j for all integers j greater than or equal with 0. So for j is equal with 0, we would have minus 1 to the power 0, which is equal with 1. For j is equal with 1, C of 1 will be minus 1 to the power 1, which is equal with minus 1, and so on. Basically, we have the elements 1, minus 1, 1, minus 1, 1, minus 1, and so on. Again, you can write in multiple ways this alternating sequence. You can start with another index, let's say k greater than or equal with 1, and then you have to basically find the sequence such that the elements, the value of the elements in the sequence will start with 1 and alternate to minus 1, 1, minus 1, and so on. We can actually write this down. So let's say I want to start, I want to write a similar sequence, but actually start with 1. So what would be D of, let's say, k for all integers k greater than or equal with 1? And again, what we would like is D of k, D of 1, to be equal with 1. Then D of 2 to be equal with minus 1. And the sequence will continue the same way. So if we are given the elements of the sequence, and let me just write a couple of them, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. What would be the general formula, the explicit formula for D of k? So for 1, we can see that the value of the alternating sequence is 1. So again, we have a power of minus 1, but the power will basically not be the value of k, because then it would be minus 1 for the first element, but k plus 1. Okay. So now we can see that actually it does match the sequence that we have. D of 1 will be minus 1 to the power 2, which is a which is an even number. So minus 1 multiplied with minus 1 will be 1. Then D of 3 will be minus 1 to the power 3, which is minus 1, and so on. I can also write this as k minus 1. So basically, it's the same formula. D of 1 will be minus 1 to the power 0, which is 1. D of 2 will be minus 1 to the power 2 minus 1, which is 1. So minus 1 to the power 1 is minus 1, and so on. So there are many different ways to write the same alternating sequence. So we wrote it now in three different ways. We started with the version that we have in the lecture notes, and we have other versions that you can write as alternative versions of this alternating sequence. Okay. So what we just did, we found an explicit formula for a given sequence. And these kind of questions are quite common as puzzles, including when you take an interview at a company. Basically, you are given the initial terms of a sequence, like, for instance, 1 minus 1 divided by 4, 1 divided by 9, minus 1 divided by 16, and so on. And the question is, can you find an alternating sequence whose elements are these elements of this formula? And of course, this can be an infinite sequence. So it's not that we stop at minus 1 divided by 36, but we actually continue with more elements afterwards. So again, we have to start with a sequence, A of k, as the general term of the sequence. And let's assume that we consider k starting from 1. So A of 1 will be the first element of this sequence. Now we look at the elements of this sequence, and if we start with 1 and then the second element is 2, the second index is 2, we can already see that the denominator of each term is the square of the index. So for instance, for the first term, 1, we can write it as 1 divided by 1 square. So the denominator of this ratio will be 1 square, 1 to the power 2. For the second element, minus 1 divided by 4, the denominator will be 2 to the power 2. So the index 2 to the power 2. For the third term, the denominator will be 3 to the power 2. For the fourth term, the denominator will be 4 to the power 2, and this continues. So for any term, we can already see that the formula in the denominator of that ratio will basically be the index to the power 2. Now, also observe that the numerator of this ratio is an alternating sequence. So for A1 is 1, for A2 is minus 1, for A3 is 1, and the formula continues. And we already computed in our previous example that if we want such an alternating sequence and we want to start from 1, like we did in a notepad, we'll start with an AK that for the first element will be minus 1 to the power k plus 1. Then for the second element will be minus 1 to the power k plus 1, which will basically be minus 1 to the power 3, which is minus 1, and so on. So now we already see the general formula for this alternating sequence, in fact. So we start with AK for all integers k greater than or equal with 1. And the numerator of this ratio will be minus 1 to the power k plus 1. And the denominator will be k squared. So the general formula for A of k for all integers k greater than or equal with 1 will basically be minus 1 to the power k plus 1 divided by k squared. This was a relatively easy formula because we can actually see easily the square in the denominator of this sequence. But in general, you will have to apply more formulas. Like, for instance, you have to apply multiplication, division, addition, subtraction of such squares, and then you will find the actual formula. And you have to practice a lot. And actually, today in the recitation, we have a set of examples for such finding the explicit formula for a sequence. So the resulting sequence in our case was A of k is equal with minus 1 to the power k plus 1 divided by k squared for all integers k greater than or equal with 1. However, we can also write an alternative sequence for the same, basically, sequence that we had before, but this time we start with k equal with 0. So in that case, basically a of k is minus 1 to the power k. So the first element will basically be positive, divided by k plus 1 square. Because when we start with k equals 0, the denominator of this fraction will basically be 0 plus 1, which is 1 to the power 2. So the first element will be 1 divided by 1, which is 1. So exactly the first element of our sequence. So you see that, again, you can find multiple alternatives for the sequence depending on multiple factors. You can actually consider the factors to be the index, where do you start as the lower limit of the indices of the sequence, or the actual formula. As I saw before, as I said before, the numerator of this ratio could be minus 1 to the power k minus 1. It doesn't have to be minus 1 to the power k plus 1. So again, you can find multiple explicit formulas for the same sequence. Any questions? No. Okay, good. Next, we define two standard notations that are used for sequences and they are used for mathematical induction. And the first notation is called the summation notation. If m and n are integers such that m is less than or equal with n, the summation notation from k equals m to n of the elements of a sequence ak is this notation, sigma, and the bottom of sigma we have k equal m, and the top of sigma we have n. So basically it's the sum for any k from m to n, a of k, and is basically the sum of all the terms in the sequence between a of m and a of n. So expanded, this will be basically the sum of all of those elements, a of m plus a of m plus 1 plus a of m plus 2 up to a of n. Again, k is named the index of that summation, m is the lower limit of the summation, and n is the upper limit of that summation. Now, I prefer to write, when I write in Notepad, for such notations, the following notation for sum. So I'm actually using this kind of like how would you use it in LaTeX to write such summations, but I'm putting the limit in one formula. So let's say that I want the sum of all the elements for any k between m and n. And then within parentheses, I will put what formula do you want, like for instance, a of k. Underscore is usually used for subscripts. And if you want, for instance, to compute a power, then you would use the hat, let's say a of k square. So basically, you can write such formulas in LaTeX, but you can also write them in Notepad++ very easily using underscore for subscripts and hat for superscripts, okay? And this is standard in markup languages like LaTeX that lets you to basically write with a keyboard a document that contains formulas. I have lectures on LaTeX posted on the class website. And during a normal semester, not during the summer, because the summer is a very fast pace, I actually ask the homeworks to be written with LaTeX, because it's a very good skill that most mathematicians and computer scientists must gain. But now during the summer is a very short semester of 6 weeks, and we have to basically cover a 15-week or 14-week material in 6 weeks. So LaTeX is not required for this class. After the class ends and you take all of the exams, you can learn LaTeX. It's a very useful skill. Okay, so let's return back to our lecture. So the summation notation is basically the sum of all the elements of a sequence or the sum of all the elements of a given explicit formula. For instance, consider that we have this sequence. A of 1 is equal with minus 2, A of 2 is equal with minus 1, a of 3 is equal with 0, a of 4 is equal with 5, a of 5 is equal with 2. You can actually write an explicit formula for this sequence. A of any k, where k starts with 1 and ends with 5, is basically k minus 3. So for k equal 1, you get 1 minus 3 is equal with minus 2, and so on. But we are interested now in the summation notation. So the sum of all the elements A of k for k equal 1 to 5 will be A of 1 plus A of 2 plus A of 3 and so on up to A of 5, which is equal with the sum of all of those elements. So in our case, we can actually see that minus 2 reduces with 2, minus 1 reduces with 1, and we are basically getting 0 as the sum of the elements in this sequence. Another sum below, we actually have a more restricted limit. So we want the sum for any k starting with 2 and ending with 2, or of A of k. But that actually is only A of 2, which is just the element A of 2, which is minus 1. Finally, we want the sum of all for all k's between 1 and 2 of A of 2k. So now we basically see that is actually A of 2, because the index will become 2 multiplied with 1, plus A of 4, because the index becomes 2 multiplied with 2. So it's A of 2 is minus 1, A of 4 is 1, and the sum is equal with 0. Summation is extremely useful when we start proving properties of summations using induction, because it gives us a compact way to represent a large formula. Let's see a few more examples. So for instance, we want to compute the sum for any k between 1 and 5 of k squared. So now we have an explicit notation directly in the sum itself. That will be equal with 1 squared plus 2 squared plus 3 squared plus 4 squared plus 5 squared, which is equal with 55. It's an easy sum to compute. You can also expand or unfold the entire summation into the formula that you are looking to expand, even if that summation has a lot of elements or an unbounded set of elements. So for instance, let's take a look at the following sum. We want to expand or change from the summation notation to the expanded form. The sum for any I starting from 0 to n of minus 1 to the power I divided by I plus 1. So this is exactly the sum A of I that we saw before. We had to actually had to find the expanded the explicit formula for the sequence that we were given. So now when we expand this summation, it will be minus 1 to the power 0 divided by 0 plus 1 plus minus 1 to the power 1 divided by 1 plus 1 plus minus 1 to the power 2 divided by 2 plus 1, and so on up to minus 1 to the power n divided by n plus 1. So basically, we expand it, and we know what is the form, the general form of any element, because basically we have the last element, which is still a variable, n. Now we can simplify the inner formulas. So minus 1 to the power 0 becomes 1. Minus 1 to the power 1 becomes minus 1, minus 1 to the power 2 becomes 1, and so on. So now we have all of these elements in the sum. And if we also want to expand, to transform the minus 1 from the numerator to put it in the sign of the summation of the higher of the bigger formula, we basically have the formula below, which is 1 minus 1 divided by 2 plus 1 divided by 3 minus 1 divided by 4 and so on. Later, we'll actually find and prove a formula for such a sequence using induction. But we leave this for later. So for now, we just expanded it into the expanded form. Also, Sometimes if you see the general formula for every element of the sequence, you can change the expanded form into the summation notation. So this is called folding. The previous actually step was called unfolding. You are basically giving a summation and you unfold it into the expanded form. Now you are given the expanded form and you want to fold it into a summation notation, into a more compact notation. So now we can actually see that we can actually find the general term of the elements of this sum. And again, it depends on how you actually start the range, because if you consider the first term to correspond for to index k is equal with 0, then the general formula for this expanded form will be k plus 1 divided by n plus k. Because for k equals 0, this will become 1 divided by n. For k equal 1, this will become 2 divided by n plus 1, which is the second form, the second operand of this summation. So basically, now we can fold that entire summation into the sum from k is equal with 0 to n of k plus 1 divided by n plus k. But again, this depends on what is the range, because the same sum, let's write it down, so the same sum, we have this sum for any k starting from 1 up to n, and the sum was k plus 1 divided by n plus k. So let's just write it. You understand that we have the sum division, the first numerator and the first and the denominator of that sum. I will not put another set of parentheses around the numerator and denominator, because basically it's just, it makes it too verbose. So if I want to change this from k equals 0 to n minus 1, that formula, so here we have, actually no, in the first case we had from 0 to n. So now if I want, I can write it from 1 to n plus 1, and in that case I don't need to add 1, so it will be k divided by n plus k minus 1. If I expand it, I can actually say that for 1 will be 1 divided by n plus 1 div minus 1, which is 1 divided by n plus, and now you can see that for k equal 2 it will be 2 divided by n plus 2 minus 1, which is n plus 1, and so on up to when k is equal with n plus 1 will become n plus 1 divided by n. Let's actually write it down, this inner formula. It will be n plus 1 minus 1, but 1 minus 1 is basically 0. So this will basically be n plus 1 divided by n plus n, which is actually n plus 1 divided by 2n, which is the last element of this expanded formula. So the same summation that we saw before, starting from 0, can actually be rewritten into that summation notation. So there are multiple summation notations that represent actually the same sum. Okay? Just the range differs. Okay? Now, evaluating sequences for given limits. So let's assume that we are given this summation notation, sum, which is 1 divided by 2 plus 1 divided by 6 plus 1 divided by 12 up to 1 divided by n multiplied with n plus 1. So now if you are given the upper limit, what's the value of n, then you can actually expand the sum and compute it. So in the case of n equal 1 will be 1 divided by 1 multiplied with 2, which is 1 divided by 2. for n equal 2, we have the first two terms of this sum, because we can see that we actually stop the moment that this becomes 2 and n plus 1 becomes 3. So it will be 1 divided by 2 plus 1 divided by 6, which is 2 divided by 3. After bringing both to the same denominator, we multiply the first fraction, both numerator and denominator, with 3. And we will get 3 plus 1 divided by 6, which reduces both terms with 2. And we get it 2 divided by 3, and so on. We can see that the sum is actually computes to n divided by n plus 1. So that's actually a formula that we will see. How do we actually compute it? How do we actually expand, find the general formula to represent this sum for no matter what n is? But before we do that, let's talk about recursion. So I don't know if you noticed this term before in your previous classes or high school, but recursion is a way to write a general form of a formula in terms of previous elements. And it actually needs two cases. The base case for the lower limit. So for instance, in the case of the summation notation, the sum from k equal m to m, so that's only one element, for any a of k will be a of m. Basically, we start with the base case. What is the value of the first element? And then we are given a recursive formula. So in the case of sum, it's very easy to find. If for any n greater than m, strictly greater than m, the sum of from for k equal m to n of a of k is the sum of all the k from m to n minus 1 of a of k plus a of n. So it's basically from an expanded form, we take out the last element, and now we have the sum of all of the elements up to the element prior to the last element. So for instance, if we are given compute the sum of all the elements for I equal 1 to n plus 1 of 1 divided by I square, we can actually use recursion to express it as equal with the sum for all I equal with 1 to n of 1 divided by I square plus 1 divided by n plus 1 square. So it's basically we extracted out the last element. Similarly, it can be used to fold in an element. So sometimes you have to unfold an element, like the last element. Sometimes you want to fold in an element so you get a more compact form. So if we have the sum for all k equals 0 to n of 2 to the power k plus 2 to the power n plus 1, then we can actually see that we can actually fold in this element in the sum, and we are getting that that is equal with the sum for all k from 0 to n plus 1 of 2 to the power k. So we can actually unfold from a sum using recursion and fold into a sum using recursion. This is mostly useful for programming such formulas into computer programs. So basically, let's say that you want to compute a function that is defined recursively, like factorial. We will cover later factorial. N factorial is the product of all the elements from 1 to n. But the way that you usually can expand it is that that product of all the elements from 1 to n can be represented as the n minus 1 factorial multiplied with the last element. So now you call recursively the same function to compute the product of n minus 1, and then you multiply that with the last element until you reach a base case, like for instance, 0 factorial of 0 is equal with 1. So you can write a recursive function that computes basically n factorial by calling recursively n minus 1 factorial. Now let's return to our examples of summations. So let's assume that we want to compute the following sum, the sum of all the elements from k equal 1 to n of 1 divided by k multiplied with k plus 1. So now we have to observe that actually 1 divided by k multiplied with k plus 1 can be actually rewritten into 1 divided by k minus 1 divided by k plus 1. And how do we do that? 1 can be rewritten in the numerator as k plus 1 minus k. We can see that basically k with k minus 1 will be reduced, and we are getting what it was, the original numerator. Now we can break that into two different operands of this subtraction. So it will be k plus 1 divided by k multiplied with k plus 1 minus k divided by k multiplied with k plus 1. But in both of the operands, we can reduce one of the terms in the denominator. So k plus 1 divided by k multiplied with k plus 1 will reduce k plus 1 with k plus 1. So we are left with 1 divided by k. And in the second operand of that subtraction, k reduces with k, and we get 1 divided by k plus 1. So when we expand a sum, like the one that we have below, that what is the sum of for all k's from 1 to n of 1 divided by k multiplied with k plus 1 is the same with expanding the sum for the same limits, k equal 1 to n of 1 divided by k minus 1 divided by k plus 1. And now for k equal 1 will be 1 divided by 1 minus 1 divided by 1 plus 1, which is 1 divided by 2. For a k equal 2, it will be 1 divided by 2 minus 1 divided by 3. And this continues up to the last element, which will be 1 divided by n minus 1 divided by n plus 1. We can also write the previous to the last element. So for k equal n minus 1, the element in that sequence will be 1 divided by n minus 1 minus 1 divided by n. But now we can actually see that in consecutive elements of this sum, we can reduce one term. Minus 1 divided by 2 plus 1 divided by 2 is 0. Minus 1 divided by 3 plus 1 divided by 3 is 0. And so on up to the last sum, which is minus 1 divided by n plus 1 divided by n is 0. So in fact, after reducing all of these terms, we are left with the first element and the last element. So telescoping this sum will basically reduce to one single subtraction, which is 1 minus 1 divided by n plus 1. Okay. So it's extremely easy to telescope this sum. Basically, if someone will tell us what is the value of this sum for n equal 10. We can directly go to the end. So it will be 1 minus 1 divided by 11. Easy. And then we basically compute that subtraction. Okay. Okay. So it will be 10 divided by 11. Yes. What is any questions? No. Okay. Again, you can ask me any questions during the lecture. Good. Next, until now we talked about sums, but the same can be used for products. Basically, the product for any k from m to from k equal m to n of the sequence A of k is this notation, the product for k equal m to n of A of k. The letter that is used here is the Greek alphabet letter pi. We use sigma for summations. For any m and n integers, with the condition that m must be less than or equal with n, it's basically the product of all of the terms A of m a of n plus 1, a of n plus 2, up to a of n. And this is the expanded form. So basically that product is the product of all of the elements within the range, including m and including n. For instance, the product for k equal 1 to 5 of a of k will be the product of a of 1 plus multiply with a of 2 multiply with a of 3 multiply with a of 4 multiply with a of 5. Similarly, if actually we are using an explicit formula in the elements of the product, now the product from for k equal 1 to 5 of k will be basically the product of those the elements between that sequence. So it's actually 5 factorial, is 1 multiply with 2 multiply with 3 multiply with 4 multiply with 5, which is 120. Okay. Again, we have a recursive definition for product. So we have a base case that for k equal m, so basically for the product for k equal m, from k equal m to m is basically just a of m. And then we have the recursive formula that says that the product for from k equal m to n of a of k is equal with the product for k equal m to m n minus 1 of a of k multiplied with a of n. So we extracted the last term out of that product. And this is true for all n strictly greater with m. So basically we can expand the product. We can basically unfold the last element of the product. And similarly, if we actually see an explicit version of this product, we can fold it. We can basically take the last element back in. And that's the opposite operation. So basically, we have these two notations, sigma for summation and the product for product. Now, there are the following two ways to fold sequences into for multiple summations into one summation, and similarly for multiple products into one product. These are extremely important. We are going to use them to prove other summations later. Okay. So if we see that the range is actually the same for two sums, and we are involved into one sum of such two sums, so basically we have the sum from k equal m to n of a of k plus the sum from k equal m to n of b of k, then we can fold these two sums into one sum from k equal m to n of a of k plus b of k. So basically we fold two sums which range over the same set of integers, same range of integers, into one sum. Similar, if we have the product of two product notations, the product of from k equal m to n of a of k, and the product of from k equal m to n of b of k, we can write this product as one product notation from k equal m to n of a of k multiply with b of k. Similarly, if we have a constant c, any real number, and c is multiplied with a sum, we can use the distributive law for multiplication over summation, that this is basically the product between c and the product notation from k equal m to n of a of k is equal with the product notation from k equal m to n of c multiplied with a of k. Basically, we are folding that common factor that was outside the sum inside the sum. So we get again a more compact notation. Using those properties of summation and product, we can basically fold a bigger formula into a smaller formula. So consider that we have the following two sequences. A of k is k plus 1, and B of k is k minus 1. And we are given the following formula to compute. The sum from k equal m to n of A of k plus 2 multiplied with the sum from k equal m to n of B of k. So first thing that I'm going to do, I'm going to actually use the explicit formula for A of k and B of k. So this is equal with the sum from k equal m to n of k plus 1 plus 2 multiplied with the sum from k equal m to n of k minus 1. Now I'm using the second generalized distributive law that I can fold basically scalar multiplications inside the sum. So the second sum becomes the sum, the second product in this summation becomes the sum from k equal m to n of 2 multiplied with k minus 1. Now we observe that we have two summations over the same range. So we can fold them into one sum from k equal m to n of k plus 1 plus 2k minus 1. But the second product becomes 2k minus 2. So this becomes k minus plus 2k, which is 3k, plus 1 minus 2, which becomes minus 1. So this sum basically becomes the sum from k equal m to n of 3k minus 1. Similarly with product. So we are given the two sequences, A of k is k plus 1, B of k is k minus 1, and we want to compute the following formula. The product from k equal m to n of A of k with the product of k equal from k equal m to n of B of k. So now we basically use the explicit formula for A of k and B of k. So we get the product from k equal m to n of k plus 1 with the product of multiply with the product from k equal m to n of k minus 1. We observe that we have a product of two product notations within the same range. So we can actually fold it into one single product from k equal m to n of k plus 1 multiplied with k minus 1. But now we can actually see that this is equal with k square plus k minus k minus 1. K minus k is reduced to 0. And we get the product from k equal m to n of k square minus 1. Also, we can change the variable. So one thing that we saw when we were doing exercises is that we can change the range. And this is called change of variable. Basically, if we want, we can change the variable from one range to another range. And this is what I'm doing actually here. So let's take the following formula. We want to basically change the variable for the following sum. The sum from j equal to 2 to 4 of j minus 1 square. So the first thing that I'm going to do is to unfold this summation notation into the actual sum. So this will basically be equal with for j equal 2 is 2 minus 1 square. For j equal 3 will be 3 minus 1 square. And for j equal 4, it will be 4 minus 1 square. But 2 minus 1 is 1, so the first term becomes 1 square. 3 minus 1 is 2, so the second term becomes 2 square. And the third term becomes 4 minus 1 square, which is 3 square. Now, if I have to fold back into a sequence, we can see that it's easier to actually start from the lower range 1 and end to the upper range 3 for the index. So we rewrite this summation as summation notation into the sum for every from every k equal 1 to 3 of k square. This is called change of variable. You basically had an original variable that ranged between 2 and 4 with an explicit formula inside the sum. Now we have a new variable, and you should use different variables because otherwise you will actually produce confusion, especially if they are in the same equality. Now you can't actually, you could, but you can't distinguish easily between the two variables. And beside that, if you can use a new variable, why not to, instead of having some kind of misunderstandings later? So now, basically, we change the range, we change the variable from j equal 2 to 4 into k equal 1 to 3. Okay. So this is called change of variable. Sometimes you are actually given the sum, like the sum for every k from 0 to 6 of 1 divided by k plus 1. And you are told change the variable k into a new variable j, where j will be equal with k plus 1. So the first thing that you should do is to look how the inner formula changes. So the inner formula was 1 divided by k plus 1. Now, if you replace 1 divided by k plus 1, if you subtract from this equation j equal with k plus 1, 1, you would get that k is equal with j minus 1. So in our formula, 1 divided by k plus 1, you replace k with j minus 1. So it will be 1 divided by j minus 1 plus 1. 1 minus 1 becomes 0. So it will become, the inner formula will become 1 divided by j. Now you have to also look at the to the range of the index. So for k equals 0, j will become 0 plus 1, so j will become 1. For k equals 6, the upper limit of that sequence, we get 6 plus 1, which becomes 7. So basically now we can rewrite the summation into the sum from j equal 1 to 7 of 1 divided by j. This is called change of variable. Basically, you are given an initial summation notation. A change of variable, in this case that j is equal with k plus 1, and that will bring us to a new summation notation with a different range and a different explicit formula of the sequence of the elements of the sequence inside that summation notation. So this is called change of variable. It lets us to, in some cases, write a simpler, more compact notation for the same sum. Any questions up to now? Okay, good. No questions. Good. Next, we will learn a different product notation for a specific product in mathematics called factorial. So the quantity n factorial that is expressed by n explanations sign is defined as the product of all integers from 1 to n. So n factorial is basically 1 multiply with 2 multiply with 3 up to n. Okay. 0 has also a 0 factorial. And because there are no elements from 1 to 0, we can actually see that 0 is less than 1. We define 0 factorial as being equal with 1. So this is basically the base case. And then for any n greater, strictly greater than 0, so starting with 1, we'll have that recursive definition. So for instance, we can see the following examples. 0 factorial will be equal with 1, 1 factorial is the product of all the integers from 1 to 1, so it's just 1. 2 factorial is 2 multiplied with 1, which is equal with 2. 3 factorial is 3 multiplied with 2 multiplied with 1, which is 6. 4 factorial is 4 multiplied with 3 multiplied with 2 multiplied with 1. And actually, we already see that 3 multiplied with 2 multiplied with 1 was 3 factorial. So there is a recursive definition here that 4 factorial is 4 multiplied with 3 factorial. So it's actually 4 multiplied with 6, which is 24. 5 factorial will be 5 multiplied with 4 factorial, which is 5 multiplied with 24, which is 120, and so on. We can actually see that 12 factorial is already 479,001,600. Note that factorial grows very fast. Like in 12 steps, we got to hundreds of millions. So it's a function, it's a notation that is a compact notation for extremely big numbers. In fact, if you want to compute in Java, a programming language that you probably learn later if you are doing a computer science major or you already learned it, if you want to write factorial of 50 is already impossible to represent as an integer. You will have to use big types, like for instance big integer, to represent these numbers that have a finite number of digits but which cannot be represented in memory locations of 32 bits. Okay, so you actually need really big numbers to represent factorials, and you can represent them for a finite number of values. You can't, for big values, you can't represent them on a even if your computer has terabytes of RAM. Now let's return to the mathematics. A recursive definition for factorial is given below. We basically start n factorial is equal with 1 if n is equal with 0, because we saw 0 factorial is defined as being equal with 1. Otherwise, for any n greater than equal with 1, n factorial is actually n multiplied with n minus 1 factorial. And that is actually very useful for reducing fractions. So for instance, 8 factorial divided by 7 factorial doesn't require you to compute 8 factorial and 7 factorial. You can just expand using recursion 8 factorial into 8 multiplied with 7 factorial. Then reducing this fraction, 7 factorial in the numerator with 7 factorial in the denominator. And that will be equal with 8 only. Okay. Similarly, if you want to compute 5 factorial divided by 2 factorial multiplied with 3 factorial, you can expand first 5 factorial into 5 multiplied with 4 multiplied with 3 factorial, reduce 3 factorial in the numerator with 3 factorial in the denominator, and then you basically get 5 multiplied with 4 divided by 2. Which is 5 multiplied with 2, which is 10. So easily you can basically do the reduction. Even if you have a fraction that contains a variable, like n plus 1 factorial divided by n factorial, you can now use recursion to expand it into n plus 1 multiplied with n factorial divided by n factorial, reduce n factorial with n factorial, and you get n plus 1. Also, another more complex formula, n factorial divided by n minus 3 factorial, expand n factorial into n multiply with n minus 1 multiply with n minus 2 multiply with n minus 3 factorial, reduce n minus 3 factorial with n minus 3 factorial, and this will be equal with n multiply with n minus 1 multiply with n minus 2. And if you execute the multiplications, you will get n cubed minus 3n squared plus 2n. So you can basically use the recursion to simplify the fraction into a formula that has only a summation, basically, and product. Next, Another notation that we will learn today is called n choose r. And we have this notation, parentheses, where you have n as the upper operand and r as the lower operand. It represents the number, the count of all the subsets of a size r that can be chosen from a set of n elements for n and r integers, with r ranging from 0 to n. So it's very similar to, we'll return back to a question I saw it now in the chat for probably one of the previous slides. Until I actually discuss about choose, please let me know what slide number you have seen that change of variable. I assume that this slide number. Okay. So we'll actually do this now. Okay. So the original formula was this. Basically, let's write it down in the slides in a notepad. So the original formula was the sum for k equal 0 to 6 for 1 divided by k plus 1. And I'm not going to use parentheses for the denominator. You already know it. As I said, just use the grouping. I don't want to be extra verbose if it's not necessary. And we do want to do change of variable. And June is asking, what about k is equal with 3j? Can we use change of variable? K is equal with 3j. Now, the problem is that the elements in a summation notation have to be consecutive. So now, how would you write it as consecutive elements if j will be basically not consecutive as integers? And we are looking now at this 3j as being basically a sum of indices that are not integers. So again, the elements of the sum have to be a sequence. And for sequences, we said that the indices have to be integers. So we cannot do such a summation notation. Basically, the index must be an integer. And as you can basically say, what will be j for k equal 1? So for k equal 1, j will be not an integer, will be 1 divided by 3. So we cannot do a change of variable for such cases. Okay. But we can do a change of variable if you would have something like this. What would be the summation notation if you have k is equal with 3 plus j? So again, first thing that you have to do is rewrite the inner formula. So 1 divided by k plus 1 becomes 1 divided by 3 plus j plus 1, which is basically 1 divided by j plus 4. Now, you have to basically extract what is the value of j, what is the range, basically, for k equals 0, what will be the value that you obtain for j. So first of all, let's rewrite this. Let's subtract in both sides, both sides of this formula. Let's subtract on both sides 3. So now we will get that j is equal with k minus 3. Okay. So now for k equals 0, j becomes 0 minus 3, so it's becoming minus 3. So the lower limit is minus 3. For k is equal to 6, we'll basically get j is equal with 6 minus 3, which is equal with 3. Now our original sum, let's write it down, will basically be the same with the sum for any j from minus 3 to 3 of, and here we have y 1 divided by j plus 4. So basically now we did a change of variable from k from 0 to 6 into j from minus 3 to 3. And you can see the range, basically k will become j plus 3. So for 0 will be minus 3 plus 3 is 0. And the formula, k 1 divided by k plus 1 becomes 1 divided by k plus j. Yes, change of variable can only be done for addition and subtraction, because otherwise you would not have consecutive integers for your indices of that summation. So yes, you are completely right. You basically have change of variable only for summations and subtractions. Okay, let me actually do another example. So the same summation, but in this case, let's say that the change of variable is 3, j minus 3. Okay. So again, first of all, you have to see what would you do. So let's do j minus 3. And instead of subtracting 3, we will add 3. And now it becomes that actually j is equal with k plus 3. Our formula, 1 divided by k plus 1, becomes 1 divided by j minus 3 plus 1, which actually becomes 1 divided by j minus 2. For k equal 0, we have j is equal with k plus 3. So we'll basically be j is equal with 3. For k equals 6, we have j is equal with 6 plus 3, which is equal with 9. So now the sum becomes basically the sum from j equal 3 to 9 for 1 divided by j plus minus 2. We did another change of variable in a couple of seconds. I will post the notes after the lecture today. So let me actually make this the lecture. Okay. Any other questions? Good. Okay. So let's return back to the lecture. So we learned factorial. We learn the choose. Actually, now we are learning the choose. So n choose r is the number of possible subsets, different unique subsets, of size r that can be chosen from a set of n elements for n and r integers and r less than equal with n and greater than equal with 0. So for instance, let's actually see how many such subsets are for the set S that has 4 elements, 1, 2, 3, 4. And now what you're basically doing, you find all of the possible subsets of 2 elements out of that set. So we can choose the first element and the second element, 1 and 2. We can choose 1 and 3, 1 and 4, 2 and 3, 2 and 4, and 3 and 4. So there are 6 such possible subsets. So the 4 choose 2, basically, which means that given a set of 4 elements, if I want to compute the number of all of the possible subsets of the size 2 out of the 4 elements, that will be basically 6. Okay. Now, there is actually a formula that gives me this without having to enumerate all of the subsets. And that is n factorial divided by r factorial multiplied with n minus r factorial. So n choose r is basically this this formula. Now let's see if it does apply for 4 choose 2. So 4 choose 2, given that formula, is 4 factorial divided by 2 factorial multiplied with 4 minus 2 factorial, which is also 2 factorial. Now, you can actually expand 4 factorial into 4 multiplied with 3 multiplied with 2 factorial divided by 2 factorial multiplied with 2 factorial. We can reduce 2 factorial with 2 factorial, so we are left with 4 multiplied with 3 divided by 2, which is 12 divided by 2, which is equal with 6. So this formula works for our example. Indeed, if you want to construct all the possible subsets of 2 elements out of a set of 4 elements, there are 6 such unique different subsets. Similarly, you can actually compute this number of, let's say, choosing all the possible subsets of 5 elements out of a set of 8 elements without having to build that. Will be 8 factorial divided by 5 factorial multiplied with 8 minus 3 minus 5 factorial, which in fact will basically be, let me actually plug in my computer.